So we want to keep this Q&A pretty casual, pretty fun, pretty informal. You know, that's why we, you know, cut the live stream. We're just going to have fun now. The first thing I want to do is I want to actually ask some of our panelists to introduce themselves, and then I'll provide a little bit more context about why you guys are up here. But please, starting with Ben on the end.
Hello.
Hi. Hi, I'm Ben. I work at Facebook on React, and, you know, we're a pretty small team, but most of us are here, actually. I've been working a lot on the Fiber rollout, you know, bumping up the percentage of users seeing Fiber, like, almost every day, and still, so far, so good. I used to build React apps at Khan Academy. I haven't really built too many React apps recently, unfortunately. I wish I had more chance to, but we worked on, like, the conference website, got a chance to dog food all of our products. It is using Fiber, so hopefully it didn't crash for you. But yeah, that's me.
I'm Sebastian. Work on React at Facebook as well, a bunch of other stuff. Mostly spending my time philosophizing about next steps and so on.
This is pretty funny. I have one-on-ones with Ben and Sebastian every week, and my joke is every time I have a one-on-one with Ben, I leave with a lot of answers. And every time I leave a one-on-one with Sebastian, I leave with a lot of questions. Sorry to cut you off. Go ahead, Spencer.
Hey, everyone. I'm Spencer. Been working on React Native since it was an official project at Facebook a few years ago. Most recently, been working on some list stuff and a whole bunch of other random things internally and in the open source stuff that you guys have been seeing. So great to be here.
Hello. My name is Leland Richardson. I work at Airbnb on our native infrastructure team. At Airbnb, I've been mostly working on React Native for like the last year. And before that, worked on a lot of our web infrastructure and other things kind of related to the React community.
Hi, everyone. I'm Lynn Clark, and I work at Mozilla. I used to be on the DevTools team when we were converting those to React with James Long, who I'm sure is in the crowd here. But I recently switched over to emerging technologies, so working with things like WebAssembly and Rust and Servo.
Awesome. Thank you all. Yeah, so we wanted to invite Leland and Lynn up because you guys had some of the highest rated talks from yesterday. Everybody really liked that. We don't have the results in from today's talk, so we're a little bit biased towards the day one talks. I admittedly just realized that. It's my bad. But we also wanted to bring up some folks from the React core team and the React Native team. A lot of people tell us that, you know, these folks aren't as accessible as we'd like them to be. And so, if you know, there were a lot of questions that can be answered by you guys. We also have kind of Christopher and Lee standing by because there's a couple of questions about some things that I think are relevant to you guys. And maybe we have some other speakers that might want to chime in at any point. Anybody sitting kind of around here, if you guys have, you know, answers to some of these questions, you want to chime in on anything. Dominic, you got a couple questions on the feed there, so maybe we'll throw you the mic at some point as well. To kick it off, we got a lot of questions about navigation. There's a lot of stuff going on with navigation at this conference. Leland, I guess we can probably hand it to you first. What are the big differences between native navigation and React navigation?
Well, I mean, the big difference, which I hope is at least a little bit obvious from my talk, is native navigation. It was engineered explicitly for what I'm calling the brownfield case, right? Which is or a hybrid app where we actually need to interop with existing native screens. And when you have a pure JavaScript navigation solution like React Navigation, that ends up being pretty difficult. Sorry, did I understand the question correctly? Was it React Native Navigation or?
React Navigation,
okay.
The newly released.
This is a good naming
navigation.
Problem right now.
Yes. But, so it's a lot of the same words over and over again in different permutations.
Yeah.
React Navigation and Native Navigation.
Yeah, and so I think that's sort of the one kind of pivotal difference, and then there are a lot of other differences which may be considered superficial, but you know, since we're using the actual platform navigation components, we're kind of working more with the platform. There's benefits of doing that. You get kind of all the hard work of the platform vendors that have built these things. You get kind of accessibility kind of baked in by default. It's sometimes not an obvious thing I mentioned like back button behavior and stuff like that. And so all of that kind of gets included automatically because we're using those libraries. And React Navigation itself, the sort of big benefit there is that it's much more customizable because you're just using React and React views. And so if you're not wanting to implement your own sort of native navigation solution, like your own sort of custom navigation bar in native code, then you might be able to be better off using something like React Navigation where you can use React to do that customization.
Nice, thank you. Obviously, we also had a ton of questions about Fiber. So maybe Lynn and Sebastian, if you guys want to chime in for some of these questions. Which things could Fiber potentially allow in the future that are not possible today or are pretty hard to imagine or implement?
Well, that's pretty hard to imagine. So we have a few steps that we're working towards. One is the expiration times, where we're trying to figure out the best solution to solve the starvation problem. And the starvation problem is basically when you end up getting higher priority updates that starve the lower priority updates. And there's a lot of things we can do to avoid that from happening at all, but once it happens, you really want to have a fallback mechanism. But the other one is just asynchronous loading in all its form. It still has a lot of complicated pieces that ties into the bundle, the bundlers, the how you define the splitting, how you track statistics to optimize the splitting, which order you do the loading, and so on. But I'm just really excited about all the libraries that are built on top of React and how they will change their mental model for how to do loading, how we shift from where we currently are, where everything has to be done up front, to when things can be done interleaved. Another thing is just we currently try to, everything has to be shifted to native in React Native or have to be shifted to CSS in the browser, whereas with Fiber, it allows us the option to do this in JS. You can still use the native stuff, and that might be a better safety net, but if there's some advanced feature that you can't do right now in native, that it's difficult, or the API is just obscure and doesn't tie into Fiber very well, then I think a lot of things can open up there.
Anything to add, Lynn?
I guess one of the things that could be possible, and it's not clear yet exactly how much this will be useful or happen, is WebAssembly. You could actually consider introducing WebAssembly in the core of React, and that would potentially help with some of the parsing and compilation cost of startup. So WebAssembly it is decoded instead of parsed, and it's, I'm probably getting a little bit too into the weeds here, but one of the cool things is there's the potential for it to be compiled, baseline compile as it's streaming in, so that can get you even faster startup times than the already fast startup times that would give you.
Still on the topic of Fiber, a couple people wanted to know, how far along are we with the rollout of Fiber at Facebook?
Yeah, so Sebastian yesterday said Facebook's already running Fiber. That's mostly true. It is, as of this week, out to more than half of the world, which is like close to 1 billion people. Just a couple of users. We are not quite running it on React Native in prod yet, although hopefully we'll make that happen in the next few weeks. But right now, React Fiber is running in sort of a compatibility mode where we're not using any of the new asynchronous features, and it's sort of behaving in the same way that the old version did, or at least as best as we can, and that's necessary for us to be able to do the switch. We want to just get rid of the old code and switch to the new code, but then we have a long road ahead of us for figuring out how we want to do the turn on all the async features and seeing which components that'll break. You know, we have 35,000 components at Facebook, And hopefully it's like we have to change 20 or 30 of them, because I can just do that like by myself. It might take me a couple weeks. But if we have to change like 10,000 of them, then we'll need a better plan. But you know, in terms of the open source release as well, we cut an alpha yesterday morning that you can install now. It should mostly work on your apps. The two big things that we're not quite done with right now are a couple of the test utils are missing, and server rendering has not quite been implemented. But we have ideas for how we're going to do it, so don't worry. But it will take us probably a couple more months, and then hopefully we can get out a stable release. We have a couple very tiny breaking changes, but we're anticipating it will be pretty easy for everybody to update to at least the synchronous version. And then, like I said, async is a whole nother battle, and we're in the early stages, but.
You didn't instill a ton of confidence there, Ben, in that rollout.
Yeah, Fiber is awesome. You know, we're seeing great results. We think that, I mean, we're really happy with how Fiber's going. The whole team is very excited, and also Tom touched on this in the keynote. The old code base was a little harder to get into, and I think the new one's much easier to get into, and we're really excited about that, even if it'll just speed up our own productivity a little bit, because that means that you all get features faster.
Awesome. Similar question to kind of bridge the two worlds here. Someone asked, what does Fiber mean for React Native? Can we think of any ways that Fiber might help us make our React Native apps more performant or build better user experiences? What do you think, Spencer?
Like in the demo that Lynn showed, basically it lets you do a whole bunch of things without worrying about blocking higher priority stuff as often, right? So you can do updates and animations running through JavaScript if you need to, and then if you have some larger render that's triggered, you can do it in pieces while your animation continues and while your UI stays responsive without it getting blocked or lagging. So on lower-end devices, you might not want to try and run those animations at 60 frames a second in JavaScript, but you might care about having a really good tap responder so that within 100 milliseconds, you always have the app responsive, even if you're doing like a big render or something like that. So shifting away from the like maybe 16 millisecond deadline to the 100 millisecond deadline on slower mobile devices, but still enabling that responsive behavior by chunking up the bigger chunks of React rendering work. So we're pretty excited about that.
Yeah, like I said in the keynote, I think we all see this as sort of a new foundation for a lot of experimentation that's yet to come. Along those lines, a lot of people want to know, look, it seems like these are under the hood changes. Is there going to be any new developer APIs? Are there going to be any new things exposed to developers building with React that they can use in their apps? Sebastian, any ideas?
Yeah, so there's a few APIs that we're kind of thinking about. First of all, we want to make the defaults great. So if you're watching my keynote there, I was, and Lynn mentioned this as well, there's different levels of priorities. And we want to have those defaults just kind of work out of the box. Because we can tell if you're currently triggering an event from a network, or if you're triggering it from a long-running timer, or if you're triggering it from a user input, for example. But then we want to be able to opt in to different levels of priorities. So we're going to have a few APIs. The current at next tag has an unstable deferred updates. So you can make things lower priority, but we want to make that reverse, and you can opt into higher priorities. I think one thing we want to do as well is expose the animation cycles, so that one issue with coordinating animations is that you shouldn't really call requests animation frame yourself, because then there's a lot of different components that cannot coordinate, and also that those cannot coordinate together with React. So we might have an explicit animation API that lets you do that. Another thing we might do is we're working with optimizing infinite scrolls and list views, and we want to make sure that we can kind of automatically do windowing where things are lower priority at the edges, or don't update at all if they're way off screen. We can still restore state and so on.
Yeah, a lot of people wanted to know, like, is there going to be like a new type of like priority prop or something like that? Like, what can we do there? Still an open area of exploration, but there's some pretty exciting stuff going on. Bringing it back to React Native real quick, a lot of people wanted to know, what are the challenges, what are the biggest challenges we faced at Facebook and Airbnb with respect to React Native? Leland, you've been dealing with these for a long time. Spencer, maybe you have something to add as well.
Yeah, I can start it off if Leland has more to add later. I mean, you heard a lot about the history of how we started mostly with Ads Manager, kind of a greenfield app, just, you know, build the whole thing from React Native with a bunch of JavaScript mobile web developers. And then more recently, we've been doing the hybrid integration into our main apps, right? So the apps that have like a billion people using them every day. And they also have thousands of engineers hacking on them every week. And they've got lots of stuff in there, lots of infrastructure, lots of existing native code, lots of existing native views, and we have to be able to move back and forth between them and all that kind of stuff. So some of the challenges, one of the biggest ones actually has been on the data fetching side. So we have two different views. One has a completely native data stack that's fetching GraphQL, and then we have our JavaScript that's also fetching GraphQL, but they have different data stores, right? We have some hand-rolled native thing that's optimized differently on Android and iOS. And then we're using Relay in React Native and trying to get those systems to have consistency between this, you know, if they're fetching the same data, like the name of a person or something, and then they like go to their profile and they edit it, then you want all the views to have the same like consistent data experience. And so that's one of the problems, just keeping it consistent. But, you know, once you kind of solve that, then you at least have like some duplicate data problems. And so trying to make the whole system more performant, more memory efficient, and also just easy to use, so that when developers go to write some new view in React Native, it can just smoothly interop with the existing data model on the native side.
Yeah, so for React Native, there have been a lot of challenges, some I maybe could have predicted and many that I could not have. One thing is like we have a lot of engineers who are previously kind of web engineers that are now working on React Native, and you're building kind of the apps in the same way, you're using some of the same technologies. But there are some differences that are pretty important, and I think we could have done a better job educating people on those differences. One kind of common thing I was like reflecting on is like web engineers, when you're building a website, you have your like simulator is your browser, but that's like actually a pretty accurate simulator. That's what your users are using as well. In the sort of mobile development world, you have simulators also, but they're really kind of a second class citizen compared to actually testing and developing on device. And there's a lot of interaction that like you need to really understand by using a real device and interacting with it and seeing how that works. Things like tap targets and just how things feel. You don't really notice it until you actually run it on the device, and kind of pushing people to actually do that has been challenging. There are some other things, like React Native itself is still a new technology. There are still kind of problems that you wouldn't run into, like if you're just using UIKit or something on iOS, you're not gonna have these kind of like nuanced, you know, bugs that are kind of underlying that you may not know why they're happening, and you have to kind of dig in and find that out. One kind of example that comes to mind is we actually had some really subtle issues with like the JavaScript core binary on Android is compiled without the actual like proper Unicode characters for number formatting. And so in iOS, when you like format a number, it works because the locale is properly provided to JavaScript core. In Android, that locale actually isn't provided, and so number formatting in some languages is kind of messed up by default. And that's like something that it takes a lot of effort to actually figure out why that's broken. And so that's like kind of an example of one of those long tail issues that you know, once you really write something that needs to be production quality to millions of users and like you start really testing it in every possible way, you find these things out, and you know, that's kind of like the cost of React Native. Yeah, I think there's probably so many more things, but that's just a, I think maybe a good anecdotal example.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you for that, guys. The next one, we might not be able to make it all the way down the panel because you might all have the same answer. But we'll start with you, Lynn. What part of React's public API most annoys you? Sorry to put you on the spot. I have like 9 answers if you need some hints.
I actually don't think there's a part of the API that annoys me.
Cop out answer.
It's okay, you won't hurt our feelings.
Does anyone have an answer that they want to go ahead? I'm thinking about my answer.
I feel like the people that are actually, they actually have to deal with all of the issues on GitHub with the API probably have more answers than those of us that don't have to deal with those.
I have one kind of maybe sort of semantic nitpick, but the way React works is React at create element, the first argument can be a component or a string. And that string, you know, if it's div, then that turns into a like a, an actual div. And that by passing in div to React.createElement, you're actually implicitly coupling yourself to React DOM at that point. And so even if your library doesn't have in its package JSON, you know, a dependency on React DOM, as soon as you put div in there, you have a dependency. And so there are a lot of like React libraries that maybe could be like cross-platform, but aren't just because of that implicit dependency. And one of the things that the sort of returning an array in render solves is maybe that, because now we don't need to like arbitrarily wrap things in a div just because it's like the default like wrapping component. Anyway, that's my thing.
Ben, Sebastian, you guys are just straight with the API. You're cool. Everything's great.
I think the life cycles could be a little bit clearer, especially if I had to pick one. It would be component will receive props. It is one where a lot of people don't know. I think it's buried in our docs somewhere. But the only supported use of this method is to call setState in response to the new props. But people use it for all sorts of things. And I totally get that, because how would you ever guess that the only supported use is to return a new state? And so like that one in particular, I really wish we could have had it like, so you return the state or something like that. Because then at least like, you know, like everybody knows that you don't generally put side effects and get initial state. And if it was like, you know, get state from new props, I think people would get that there too.
Yeah, all the side effects is really annoying, but as we've seen, that's pretty critical for integration with anything, right? It's just really difficult to kind of ahead of time think of all the possible cases and the ordering in which things can happen. So if there's anything I would change, is get rid of all the side effects, but we can't. So we'll come up with something better.
Nice.
But one thing I wish we had was just pure functions in the language. Thanks, Brendan.
We actually had a bunch of questions about that. People want to know what percentage of Facebook's code base is pure components.
I have no idea.
I have no idea either. I was hoping maybe you knew. No, okay, we're going to skip that one.
I have maybe a comment on that.
What about Airbnb?
So pure component, we use a fair amount in React Native, but I would say almost all of our components are pure, as in they don't produce side effects other than like state, which is not an impure component. But one of the things that we've done that's I think worked really well is we've really we've strived towards using only primitive values as props. So strings, numbers, things like that. And that like allows you to write should component or like have most things be pure components just out of the box, and it's like free performance wins. And it makes things like usually much less tied to your actual like sort of business logic that you might not intentionally realize you're tying yourself to. So
nice. We got about 10 minutes left. I wanna take one from an audience member over here. Dominic, you mind coming up for this next question? It's not too hard, I promise.
Oh, sorry, I still.
How close to Inferno speed does Dominic think he can make React?
No pressure.
Make it better.
Yeah.
Eventually.
That's good. Yeah, short and sweet. That was great. I'm excited about that as well. Now, how about my man Lee Byron? We got one here about GraphQL. Welcome, Lee Byron of GraphQL fame. The question is, what is the long-term direction for Relay, and how does it compare to Apollo Client?
Oh, that's a great question. So internally at Facebook, we've actually been working on a new core and API for Relay that we're just now starting to use a handful of products in production, and we're seeing pretty amazing performance improvements when we do that, but it's still really early days for that. So one of the things that we're taking as an explicit trade-off with our new versions of Relay is not paying as much attention to making it easy to get started, but paying a lot of attention to making something that's going to be extremely high performance and have extremely good developer efficiency once you're in a fairly large product. So that works really well for our React Native applications, where we're typically running things on low-end hardware with poor network connections. And where Apollo fits in very, very well is that Apollo kind of organizationally as a whole, and Apollo Client very much fitting into this, has this mission to make it very easy to use GraphQL and to fill in all the blanks in the developer tools and the GraphQL clients so that everyone can use GraphQL. And Apollo Client is amazing, and it does an excellent job at that. So I think eventually where we'll find ourselves is on this balance. And I actually had a conversation with Shashko from Apollo yesterday about this, and he says, you know, as soon as you release the Relay core, that we're going to try to make Apollo core just as fast. And I was like, that's awesome, because that'll push us to figure out even more things. So at the end of the day, like having more than one choice for anything is always a good thing, because it forces us to figure out new ways to do things and compare and contrast and make everything better for everyone else.
Awesome. Thank you, Lee. A couple of people asked about Preact and Inferno. And they want to know, you know, what have we learned from these alternatives, these React alternatives, API compatible React alternatives? Maybe, I don't know, maybe down to you again, Sebastian, or Ben, or anyone. Yeah, go ahead.
I mean, I think they've just been pretty inspiring for us in terms of showing what's possible when you really push the envelope and, you know, maybe are a little bit more lax about, you know, 100% compatibility, and if you just have performance as your one goal or size as your one goal, and seeing what you can build. And I think from both projects, definitely we've, you know, they both Dominic and Jason and everybody who's worked on those has done great work, and it's been pretty exciting for us to see, like, oh, like maybe we can actually just make React that much faster and that much smaller. And so we do have serious efforts both around sort of performance for bundle size and as well as startup and runtime performance that we're really looking into. And then of course Preact and Inferno also have a few other small changes, like passing in props and state to render, which are things that we've been thinking about for many years. You can find them in one of our repos where we have some experiments We haven't added them yet just because we don't think they give you a lot over the existing object-oriented API, and it doesn't really change how you write your code. And so you might save a few characters here and there, but we'll probably adopt those sorts of things to eventually, maybe as part of maybe a, like, stateful functional components or something like that. People have been asking us for that for years, so maybe it'll come one day.
It's amazing you said stateful functional components, because that's the next question. What's the story with stateful functional components? What even is that? Sebastian, blow our minds.
So there's an interesting thing about stateful functional component. What is it? Does it mean that you express things in a more without this, but then can you have side effects? Because that's not really pure. What kind of integration can we have? Can we update state based on props? And I think one of the, and how do you invoke callbacks? Because a callback is the side effect being invoked, right? So there's a lot of APIs that you have to think about. And then we also have to think about how is the upgrade path when you're moving from one set of constraints to other set of constraints, and you want to expand more capabilities. And then how do we make it so that you don't accidentally do the wrong thing? Like, we just mentioned this out in the hallway earlier, that set state with the callback itself, you can abstract over that and just have an automatic callback that does that for you. But the key there is that this, you can't have side effect within the set state within the callback, because that can be replayed multiple times, but you can have side effects outside of that. So most people don't make those mistakes now, but if you change to a purely functional API, then you might accidentally add some side effects and not realizing that consequence.
Yeah, this is something that I really want us to focus on as a React core team in H2. I say H1, H2, I'm like a manager. But anyway, second half of this year, we really want to start thinking about this. And there's a bunch of things that we can't really take full advantage of in Fiber, especially around scheduling and some of the async stuff, until we have an API like stateful functional components where we can guarantee that nobody's setting properties on the instance and things like that. So we're excited to pick that work up. Ben, you got something to add?
Yeah, so I just wanted to say our goal whenever we're designing these APIs or a new syntax for how you define your components, our goal is how can we make it easy to build things, but in particular, how do we make it easy to go down the right path and easy to do things that will scale and won't cause you problems later? And as much as possible, avoid traps where it's easy to write some code, but then it'll come back and bite you in 6 months. And so, stateful functional components, if or when it happens, will be towards that same goal and trying to push people away from mutability and other patterns that might cause problems in the future.
That's great, thank you. I got an easy one here I'm gonna answer. Who picked the music in the conference room? It wasn't me, it was someone named Phil, and he's awesome. Phil, where are you at? He was backstage, he was playing some, what are you, hiding back there? Don't hide. He really got us going backstage because I needed a little pump up jam before we got on stage. So thank you, Phil. I can't believe someone actually asked that question. I'm glad they did. The next one, we got about 10 questions about CSS and JS. I got to ask Christopher Chedeau to come up here because he started this whole mess. let's go with an easier one for you, I think. What is the status of CSS and JS at Facebook? How do you see it in the future?
Yeah, so maybe I can give you a little bit of background around CSS and JS. So it all started with our .dot.dot stack, like our web stack. And like many years before I came to Facebook, like more than 5 years ago, some like really smart people came up with like CX and like a static way to inside of XHP, like our like React for PHP component or React component, to be able to say, oh, this needs this class name. And then it's going to do automatically find out the dependencies, like bundle your JavaScript, and like you don't have any more like global namespace and everything. And so when I joined Facebook, I was like mind blown, like this is so cool. And like fast forward a few years, I was like starting prototyping on React Native, and like we need some way to like have like styling. And so the first obvious way was to add one props per style. And so like it started like being like kind of useful, but I wanted like a real styling. And so I put like all the style into an object, like first in a different file like CSS, and then like Tomo convinced me that, oh, we should actually like put it in the same file. And I was at this point, I was like convinced that we would need CSS, like the full power of CSS at some point in the future. And but I was like super lazy, and I didn't like, I was already like re-implementing a layout engine, like the layout part of CSS, and I didn't want to like re-implement the CSS parser and like all of the rules and everything. So I was like, okay, let's try without it and see how it goes. And what really surprised me is that not only did it work, which was like surprising, but also it was solving a lot of the issues that we had with CSS. Like no more global namespace. If you want to delete some CSS, like it's in the file. So if it's not referenced anymore, like you can delete it. And there's been like all of those like good side effects that came with it. And we were like 3 months away from like announcing React Native. And one thing that we learned about React and when we announced it is like everybody focused on JSX. And like for like the first year, like was like JSX sucks, like all crazy about JSX. And I didn't want like when we announced React Native to be everyone's talking about inline style and JavaScript style and like, oh, we kill CSS. So I found like a small but like really great conference called Nation.js that did an event a few months before React, before we would announce at the first React Conf. And I was like, okay, I'm going to do a slide like CSS in JS and like to explain the concept. And I thought that would be like some amount of drama for like, I don't know, like a few days and like people would move on. But this did not happen. So I just looked at the stats today and the slides have been viewed like 800,000 times. I'm like, come on. And so I was like, okay, and then there's like so many libraries to do like CSS in JS. And at this point, I was like, myself, I was pretty satisfied with React Native, like the way we do styling. But there are like some issues like when you port it on the web. And so one thing I wanted to do is like inside of Facebook on our web stack, like use the React Native way and like put it on the web. But one thing we found out is the thing we have on like the web right now is actually working fine. And it solves like most of the problem. And like we can like get to the like 5%, but we don't want to rewrite the entire code base just for like 5% wins. And so it didn't never happened. And so at this point at Facebook, we have like our web stack which is using CX and our React Native stack which is using inline styles. And I don't see us like really coming and like changing this like radically in the future. So what I'm really hoping for is like the same way like we had Flux. And like so many Flux libraries came in, and like Redux came in, and like settled all the drama, and like now everybody's using Redux for like, yeah, MobX is different, but everybody's using Redux. So I'm really hoping that like one person or like one team is going to like find like, okay, this is how you do CSS in JS. So we've seen like Zeit, we've seen like style component, like we've seen like CSS modules and all of those things. And I wish like one of them would like come in and like be the one. But what's most exciting to me is that people are actually thinking about this now. Because before it was like, oh, CSS is like God invented CSS and everybody has to like use CSS even when it doesn't make any sense. And so like now people are stacking like creating like so many innovations and like I'm really excited. And this is why I also like started React Conf is because more than like just React the library, I want like around the ideas. Like people like thinking about new ways of doing things and like rethinking like why have we done this way? Like isn't there a better way or something like this? So yeah, long story short, like we're not Facebook going to do anything major on this.
Thank you. I love the strategy of just like going to a conference months before you know something's gonna happen and just like, okay, everyone, here's a crazy idea. And then by 3 months later, it's not that crazy anymore. Turns out people hate surprises. So yeah, that's awesome. Okay, last question for the panel here. Do you have any advice for everybody in the React community that's in this room? Any of you, do you have any advice? What would you say?
So I have a little bit of advice. I'd say that actually stepping through the code, even though you're not necessarily going to fix bugs in React itself, actually going through and stepping through the code, as I have had to do when I did talks on the Stack Reconciler and when I did it on the Fiber Reconciler, will really help you understand everything that you're doing a lot better. And I wish that I had done that sooner.
And I don't want to steal this from Tom because it's really Tom's thing, but I've been obsessing about this since he told me about it earlier this year, or last year maybe. It's about the notion of optimism-driven development. Is this, if you think about how many times we kind of face a problem as engineers, and we react negatively towards this, like, here's something that we see, and like, how are we ever gonna solve this? This is impossible. There's too many flaws, and I can see all the flaws in this plan ever that's gonna come up. And here's a list of things we have to do before we can actually complete this. But what if we go in with the mentality that instead we're optimistic? We're thinking, wow, what will this unlock? I know there's gonna be a lot of work involved, but we're gonna get there, and we're gonna solve them, and we have to do all these things to get there, but we will get there. And even if we don't, that's okay too, because we will get somewhere else that is even better. But by having that optimism, we can continue driving forward and just developing cool new technologies, like CSS inline styles and all this stuff is one example of that, where we kind of have this negative reaction, but what if we switch mentality that, wow, this is really cool. Now we have a set of problems to solve, and let's do it.
Thank you for bringing that up, Sebastian. Cool. Wait, I'm going to clap. I like that. Look, it's so easy in this community and in any community to just see something and think it's a terrible idea, shit all over everybody's ideas. We do it all the time, you know? And I truly believe that optimism is the catalyst for human progress. And we have to support each other. We have to be excited about things, even if they seem crazy or impossible. Everything we have today was impossible 20 years ago. You know, so be supportive, be optimistic.
Yeah, I'm also going to say something warm and fuzzy, which is like, you know, if like we're at a tech conference, but the tech like doesn't really matter. Like, if React was never created, I'd be here using Angular 2 or Ember or Vue or something else, and I'd be very happy, probably. Those are great libraries. And so, you know, keep making awesome stuff, but also just, you know, remember that, you know, it's more important to be nice to each other and just build cool stuff.